Hello, everybody. Please welcome Dr. François Cornud, internationally recognized expert in prostate imaging. François Cornud present today the clinical interest of multi-beam imaging for prostate lesions assessment. Please note that this is a 20-minute lecture followed by a 10-minute questions and answers session, and I will ask you to write down your questions in the chat section of the conference so Dr. Cornud could answer them at the end of the talk. Thank you very much and enjoy your conference.
Thank you, Anka. So I start. We're going to talk about diffusion. We have 20 minutes to do that. Diffusion, multi-beam diffusion of the prostate. Just a short introduction to recall that conventional MRI is based on the concentration of hydrogens from water. And this is a big difference with diffusion, which studies the displacement. The displacements of water molecules after application of two diffusion gradients. And the sequence to measure water diffusion is single shot echoplanar imaging speed echo. So the base back to the basics, but for a very short time. High cellular density, as you can see here, and intact membrane cell membranes are responsible for a restricted diffusion of water molecules here. Because the extracellular space is small and because cell membranes represent a barrier to free motion. Here, importantly, the water molecules are of the capillary network, because they also evaluated by diffusion-weighted imaging. They move faster, but they impact diffusion metrics. On the opposite, a low cellular density or defective cell membranes exhibit an increased extracellular space, and the free diffusion is thus greater. The sequence to measure the water motion is a single shot, as I said, echoplanar. Two rectangular gradients are applied before and after the 180 degrees refocusing pulse of the speed echo sequence. When the second gradient is applied, static molecules, means molecules within an area where diffusion is restricted, will be completely refaced after the second gradient pulse. And moving molecules will not be completely refaced by the second gradient because they've been totally displaced by the first gradient. And this will induce a signal loss on diffusion-weighted imaging, which is the basis of the contrast during the sequence. Now, if you use a multi-beam sequence, as we all use now, classical multi-beam, mono-exponential multi-beam sequence, if you plot here the signal intensity here against the B values with a logarithm, you trace a line through the points for each B value, and the slope characterize the ADC, the apparent diffusion coefficient, and results are depicted as a parametric map of ADC values colored in black and white to avoid confusion. So there is a high B value in the normal peripheral zone, greater than in the BPH, and of course here tumor has a low ADC value. I should draw your attention to the fact that it is recommended that the ADC map should not be calculated with a high B value over 1,000, because over 1,000 some artifacts occur, the TE is increased, the echo time is increased, and so acquired B value should not exceed 1,000 to calculate the ADC value. Now, the B exponential diffusion weighted imaging, also called by Le Bihan intravoxel incoherent motion. The question with this B exponential model is how to separate. So the B exponential is has been developed by Le Bihan and called intravoxelic motion. He distinguishes in this model two components, the capillary components here and the tissue components. In the capillary components, a pseudo diffusion is studied. And the motion of the water molecules are measured by two values. D star, also called ADC fast in UK studies, is calculated with the B values between 0 and, let's say, 100 second per square millimeter. Associated with this D star is another parameter, which is called F, called by Le Bihan, blood perfusion fraction, which represents the blood volume moving through the capillaries. And the tissue component, where the water motion is studied, by one parameter, which is D, or ADC slow of the British, with B value over 100 and 200 second by a square millimeter. With a B exponential, the curve of the signal intensity has two, by definition, is not mono exponential. The initial portion is here as a steep slope, and during this steep slope, DF, D star and F are measured, and the second part of the curve has a less steep slope, and it is with on this part of the slope where D is calculated. So the hockey stick shape of the B exponential decay of the signal intensity during a diffusion sequence has been mathematically proved to better fit to the diffusion weighted data to generate the ADC maps. It requires several low B values of less than 100 seconds per square millimeter. There is no consensus about that. When we used to do it, we used 10 B values from 0 to 100. However, despite a mathematically improved fitting of the diffusion weighted signal intensity data, when multiple B values are required, it has not been demonstrated in all the papers of the literature that separating fast from slow ADC value perform better than mono exponential ADC matrix in prostate cancer detection. So further studies are necessary to refine this model. Now, at the opposite of the scale, diffusion kurtosis. Diffusion kurtosis comes from the fact that mono exponential estimation of ADC infers a Gaussian distribution of water motion, like free motion. Free motion in water is a Gaussian, has a Gaussian distribution. But as cellularity increases, like in prostate cancer, restricted diffusion is believed to become non-Gaussian. And diffusion kurtosis quantifies the deviation of a non-Gaussian distribution compared with a Gaussian distribution. To apply diffusion kurtosis, you need a high B value at least equal to 2,000 seconds per square millimeter to detect a non-Gaussian water. Here is what I illustrate what I was saying. This is the Gaussian distribution of the free diffusion, kurtosis is zero. And this is, the red line shows a more peaked non-Gaussian distribution, the kurtosis is positive, and this happens in more complex tissue environment. The results are few, because there are few studies which has addressed the issue. There are contradictory results in the literature. In one American study, the first one, KADC, YDCK, as you are, performed better than mono-exponential ADC. In the second one, which came from Germany by Matthias Röttke, the KADC did not perform better than mono-exponential. But this paper, the second one, clearly demonstrated that the mono-exponential ADC metrics influenced the comparison, because if the high B value of the mono-exponential ADC is 2,000, that one, the one used in the decay diffusion sequence, the value of the ADC is degraded, and the German team said it was the reason to explain that the kurtosis was not better than the mono-exponential decay diffusion weighted sequence. In the paper by Rosenkranz, first one, the ADC value was calculated with a B2000 of the kurtosis sequence. And finally, this group from New York did a second study to show that if the ADC value was calculated with a high p-value not exceeding 1,000, the diffusion was not superior to the mono-exponential ADC value. That's the point at the time. There is no superiority of advanced quantitative MRI compared to a classic mono-exponential ADC matrix. Also, because there is no consistent performance of ADC matrix to differentiate prostate cancer from benign nodules, because there is a huge overlap between values, we can all understand that there is an interest in improving the accuracy of qualitative diffusion to increase the conspicuity of suspicious lesions. Because here, you need to increase the curve, but of course, you can see that the signal to nose ratio keeps decreasing after B1000. So, what is the solution? The solution is to use computed B-value greater than 2000 seconds per square millimeter. Here, an example, the signal intensity of the benign prostate keeps decreasing as the weighting in increases. At the end, let's say B4000, it can be B6000, the signal intensity of the benign prostate, gets suppressed, and the signal of the tumor remains identical. It is the basis of the contrast of a diffusion sequence. This is not bright, more white than this. It just means this impression, visual impression, is only related to the fact that the signal intensity of the normal prostate has nearly disappeared with these high B values, which are computed. And if you use the combination of this visual assessment of restricted diffusion with these high B values, combined with the NADC map, provided the high B value not exceeds 1,000, you have a nice tool at the moment to evaluate and better characterize the suspicious nodules in the PZ, and of course at a lesser degree in the TZ. Example here. This is two bilateral nodules on T2 weighted image. This one has a more nodular pattern than this one. But because diffusion is the dominant sequence, you have to have a look at the ADC map, which shows a restricted diffusion on the right side and practically no restricted diffusion on the left side. And as the B value increases, computed B values, when it raises from 1,500 to 3,000, you can see that the signal intensity of the normal benign prostate drops down and gets suppressed, while the signal of the tumor, because it was a tumor, remains on the right side, which was the less suspicious area on the T2-weighted imaging. And the biopsy findings showed a right Gleason 3 plus 4, two more, and left benign tissue on the left side. So this is the first example. Here is a second one. In PIRRS, three lesions in the PZ, you know that they are defined by a focal lesion with a mild restricted diffusion. But mild is subjective. Mild means it's moderately dark on ADC and moderately bright on, p-values you are recommended to use, that is at least 1400. And on the T2-weighted MRI, PIRRS 3 exhibits a non-well circumscribed hypersignal like in this example. The detection rate of significant cancer in this case is 6 to 45%, which is very wide variation, which means that there is definitely a problem, an issue to consistently assign a score 3 to a lesion when you have such a high range of values for the cancer detection rate of significant cancer. So now, this is a 3 plus. What does propose the PIRRS in the last version? It proposed to add a plus one here. Plus one means DC is positive. But plus one is equivalent to 4. So it should go, this patient should go to biopsy. But there is an increasing amount of evidence that the added value of DCE for detecting significant cancer in these patients is low, between 0 and 3%, and that the false positive rate is between 10 and 15%. And this decreases the specificity, which is already not very high. PIRRS is not, PIRRS, the distinction between PIRRS 3 and PIRRS 4 has not a high inter-reader concordance. So instead of using this, which is the injection of contrast medium, let's use higher B-values, higher computed B-values. Oops, sorry. Higher B-values. And B3000, B6000 just show, as in the previous example, that the signal intensity of the lesion and the benign prostate gets suppressed together. The contrast of signal intensity between the lesion and the rest of the prostate does not increase. And I don't have the results. And so, if you're not convinced by this, if you want more confidence, if you want to be more confident to try to avoid classify this as a PIRRS 4 lesion, you can also use ADC matrix. So you combine the qualitative features of multi-B, multi-computed B values, the diffusion, to the quantitative aspect. You use the ADC map with 3 B values, as recommended by the PIRRS. We had, with our equipment, a cutoff value of 10, nearly close to 1100, with a sensitivity of 90%, specificity of 67% to detect all significant cancer. And the area under the curve was very high. Importantly, in this paper, in our paper, and it was probably one of the most important findings in this paper, even if it's not, specificity is only 67%. But the important point of this paper was there was a substantial inter-reader concordance with a kappa test of 0.7, which lacks in the actual PIRRS V2.1. But this cutoff may vary across center. This is our IDC with our equipment, with our protocol, and from across center, it may vary. So the solution is to calculate a ratio, an ADC ratio, to normalize the ADC. First, the mirror ADC ratio. But to have the same sensitivity than the ADC map, we were disappointed by the specificity with an AUC of only 0.73. Because the limitation of the ratio, the mirror ADC ratio, is the placement of the ROI. If you place it, it's bright. If you place it here, it's darker. So you can understand that you cannot reproduce easily consistent results. So we had the idea, instead of using the mirror ADC ratio, to normalize the ADC with the ADC of the rest of the prostate. With a cutoff of 0.67, and again with an excellent anteroradial concordance, and I repeat, this is the most important point of this study, kappa test of 0.7, we could eliminate or detect 90% of significant cancer with a specificity of 67%. So in this example, of course, no surprise that three targeted fusion biopsies just showed benign findings. This is also an example to show how this multi-B value DWI with computed B values can help in the TZ. I don't know what pyrite score you would assign to this lesion, which seems to originate within the stroma and not in the glandular tissue of the PZ. But it's restrictive because it's dark. It's moderately bright at B2000. So it's moderately bright, but it's bright. So depending on the size of the lesion, which was more than 15 millimeters, the radiologist who interpreted this image said, this is the pyrite 5. So a cancer in nearly 90% of the cases. When we did the biopsy, processed the images with our software, which is actually the Olea software, with high computed B values. And when we saw how the signal intensity of the lesion got suppressed as you increased the weighting in diffusion, we were less convinced that this was really a cancer. So, and also, another thing which is not recommended, not anymore in the TZ, but it is questionable for the tumors originating in the anterior fibromuscular stroma. There are some supporters of the injection to show how hypervascularized these tumors can be, which is not the case here. There's no early, neither intense enhancements compared to the rest of the prostate. So this was benign tissue, mainly based on the fact that the signal intensity of the lesion decreased as the weighting in diffusion increased. If I may conclude on the interest of the multi-B sequence, we must all admit that the ideal multi-B tree exponential DWI is not yet available. Too long to calculate a fast ADC with a lot of B values with less than. Too long to ask the equipment, the platform to acquire images at 2000. So at the moment, but it's already a very good thing. We think that the characterization of PZ nodules and selectively some TZ nodules can be improved first if ADC metrics are standardized. Standardized means what? Proper placement of the ROI, two-thirds within the higher restricted area, but two-thirds of the lesion. I should have added acquisition measurement metrics or measurement of the ADC value with a high B value, which should not exceed 1,000. And third, maybe you can use the whole prostate ADC ratio, which is not better than the ADC map. Huh? It's not better. It just shows that it can be used as we do when we see examinations coming from a different center. And the second point, which is quite complementary to the first one, is to use a multi-B high B value with B values at least 2,000 seconds per square millimeter to see how the signal intensity of the lesion decrease compared to that of the rest of the prostate. The ideal would be to have an array so that the B-value, computed B-value, would be a continuous variable to determine the best cutoff which could be used to see how the signal intensity is best, the signal intensity of the normal prostate is best suppressed compared to the signal intensity of the suspicious lesion. That's the, I think, maybe available in a short future. So I think it's okay for me. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, François, for this very interesting talk. There are just a few questions. From a practical standpoint, what B values would you recommend for an optimal assessment of lesions? What acquired values plus what values you are going to compute after acquiring?
Okay, acquired B value should not exceed B1000. I repeated that. I mean it. This is so important, it should be repeated, repeatedly. Okay, because some centers definitely use play with protocols. They just play with protocols. They decide to calculate to acquire a B1500. Then some of them calculate a B2000. No, we should be homogeneous. If you want to acquire, for the NC map, don't acquire with a high B value higher than 1000. If you want to use a higher B value to increase the conspicuity of the tumors, you can use a B1500 or even a B2000, but you have to acquire it in a separate sequence. It's a second recommendation. But I can tell you that B value superior to B2000 is necessary. And if you admit that it is necessary, you have to use, let's say, all the manufacturers now provide a computed B value higher than 2000. All of them, you can have a computed high B value of 3000, which is quite good already, which definitely increases the conspicuity of the tumors. The problem is that the B2000 will be good for some patients, B3000 will be good for some patients, and etc. B4000 for some other patients, and even for selected patients, B values higher than B4000 up to 5000, as showed by the group of Dagbegger. So that's what I say. A cursor which could display a continuous computed B value until you find the best cutoff to differentiate with the highest accuracy the signal intensity of a suspicious lesion from that of the rest of the protein. I don't know why the same B value cannot be used for a higher B value, cannot be used with the same efficacy for every patient. For some of them it's 2000, for some of them it's 4000, and occasionally it is 6000. So a compromise, if you have only one, would be to use 3000. It seems to be quite interesting that we have routinely on the equipment, on the platform. The platform shows for free any diffusion sequence with three B values to acquire and one computed B values at 3000 for the visual evaluation of the case. Does that answer to your question?
Yes, thank you very much, François. One last question. Do you think that multi-B, once there's going to be a consensus on the protocol and post-processing of calculated Bs, could be more sensitive and more specific than DCE and therefore ultimately replace it?
So the question is, briefly, I think the question was, does diffusion will replace DTE in the short future or not?
Yes.
Yes, it is. There is some evidence for there is still some supporters from the DCE, but supporters of the DCE, several categories of supporters. First, those who do not have a good quality in diffusion, and what I didn't have time to say, but I may have said that good quality in diffusion it requires a good patient preparation. Those who are not convinced that an empty rectum, for instance, is a prerequisite for a good quality of diffusion, may make a mistake, and we see many. So this requires an enema, not an enema, a laxative. Not an enema, a laxative is enough. 1 or 2 hours before the examination. In our center, we're very an obsession of rectal cleaning. So the technician put a small female bladder catheter, small female bladder catheter to spy the air in the rectum just before the examination. This is and under these circumstances, if you use that, if you take all this caution, that is caution means that only thinkable in centers who have high volume, who have a pool of doctors and a pool of technicians who are really involved in prostate imaging. To place a prostate in a case between a session of 10 or 10 knee MRIs or ankle or musculoskeletal, as for me, is hopeless. You need to have a really convinced and highly trained staff and motivated to do prostate cases, many prostate cases, 10 per week is a good volume. That's what. And then with these portions, I think that DCE, except in cases where diffusion shows artifacts, there are only these cases where DCE will be still give useful information, like hip replacement, diffusion artifact. Sometimes you cannot avoid, especially at 3T. But these are really selected indications of DCE. But if I can add something, and this is the paradox, it's that DCE is still useful in large volume tumor when extra prostatic spread is suspected. In these patients, you probably have a better results, more accuracy to detect early invasion of the seminal vesicles, for instance. But again, it's highly selected patients. So it means that you have to decide at the very last moment that you should put a line to inject contrast medium. Again, you need very good technicians to do that, or you need at least to place a line at the beginning of the examination for each patient and decide when necessary to inject contrast injection. For that, you need to be in front of the screen. You have to be at the workstation. You have to be there. And in this case, you can use the DCE in selected cases for extra prostatic spread. I think it's a good idea. That's it.
Another question, François, from the audience. Is it okay to use higher B values than 1,000 if for radiologists who want to see normal prostate totally black on diffusion?
No, you mean B values higher than 1,000? Yeah, of course, because you have the T2 effect, which is not suppressed at 1,000. So the T2 effect is not suppressed. So sometimes, at the maximum, you don't see the cancer yet. At 1,000, the cancer, because the T2 effect showed that the it's bright. You have to increase at least to, as I said, to 15,000 or 1,500 or 2,000 to start to see the decrease in the signal intensity of the normal prostate. But at B1,000, sometimes you just don't see the tumor. You see it at B0 because B0 is a T2 weighted image. You see it at B0, but it's not specific at all, and then it disappears at B500. It disappears at 1,000, and then it gets bright. It gets bright at 1,500 or 2,000, because the restricted diffusion is appears at these values. You absolutely need high B values. Everybody should understand that now. It should be clear for everybody that very high B values are very useful to increase the conspicuity and improve what is really poor with the PI-RADS, even in its last version. It is the inter-reader concordance between PI-RADS 3 and PI-RADS 4, because there is nothing more subjective than to assign a score on the basis of a mild restricted diffusion, visually assessed, from a marked diffusion, restricted diffusion. To do that with more confidence, you need to display, to increase the conspicuity of suspicion lesion compared to the rest of the prostate. I'm convinced, I mean it.
Thank you very much, François. One last question before we close the session. Have you investigated how do computed B values compare to acquired B values? Meaning, are there differences between the same acquired versus computed B value?
No, they're not. They have an excellent signal to noise ratio. This has been really demonstrated by the group of Dijkbergen. They have an excellent SNR and even improved, so according to what said Sheenan, the physicist from. And I think that if you have if you want to avoid to tease the magnet to ask him to do things he cannot do, of course you will obtain definitely and consistently better results, better conspicuity of computed B values than with acquired B values over 1,000. No doubt about that. It's a point of no way back. Computed B values are going to be routine. I'm sure of that.
Thank you very much. That was the last question. Thank you all for having assisted to this, having attended this webinar.
Thank you to all of you, and have a good day.